First of all, I have to say, a fellow Nikki, you're also a Nicole, right? I grew up, I was Nikki, N-I-K-K-I. And now just my family still calls me Nikki and friends from way back. So we have that in common. Also, so tell us about you.
Yeah, I'm definitely Nicole. The only time that I get called Nicole was when I used to actually be in the courtroom. And I used to make my clients and then obviously the judges. It's and when my dad gets mad at me, he still calls me Nicole.
Yes. No, I remember all through school, through elementary and high school, first day of school, they'd go down, you know, the names, Nicole Sandler. Yeah, it's Nikki. It was always Nikki as a kid. And then once I got out of college, I thought, I guess I should be Nicole now. So anyway, it was an unusual name when I was a kid. I'm a bit older than you are. Now there are Nikkis everywhere. So we're trailblazers. Anyway, Nikki Fried, a lot of people who are listening maybe don't know you. You are the Commissioner of Agriculture and Consumer Services here in Florida. That's sort of a weird combination, is it? Agriculture and consumer services, why do they go together?
Yeah, so there's like some history on this. So the Ag Commissioner is in our Constitution. And when they had over time kind of changed the makeup of the cabinet, they got rid of some positions. And so over time, they kept trying to figure out, well, who was going to be responsible for this activity or who's responsible for that one? And at the time, there was an Ag Commissioner who kept just raising his hand and said, we'll take it over here. And so they expanded this position to not just be agriculture, but agriculture consumer services. The other aspect of it is there were some times when there was a threat to taking it out of the Constitution. And so the ag community felt, well, maybe if we just create such a big position with so many responsibilities, that will help us keep the Commissioner of Agriculture as a constitutional officer.
Did you have any involvement with the world of agriculture before taking on this position?
Well, I came from the marijuana space. So that's kind of where my ag background comes from is I was very involved in the medical marijuana program here in the state of Florida. Also one of the lead just government consultants across the country on this issue. So I do fundamentally believe that the future of agriculture is the cannabis plant. And so feeling that that's kind of where the synergy had come from when I decided to run for ag commissioner.
You know, I love hearing that. I'm astounded. Look, we live in the Sunshine State. Things grow here like weeds. Go figure. Weeds. The fact that we're not growing it and taxing it and making a fortune and filling our coffers is frankly astounding to me. But, you know, you won't appreciate it. But as I refer to the state, it's Florida. I want to get the duh out of Florida. So this sounds like a no-brainer to me, but hey, we were on the road to getting close to having recreational marijuana on the ballot coming up, and then all of a sudden we're not. What happened with that?
Yeah, it's unfortunate. The Supreme Court kicked the ballot initiative, two of them, actually. There was two ballot initiatives that were being worked on. One that basically regulated it no different than they do alcohol. So basically, like you see the alcohol stores and licensing underneath that. The other one was a more restricted program, but still allowing for access and for legalization. The Supreme Court kicked both of those initiatives out. Obviously, I do not agree with that ruling by any stretch of the imagination. And, you know, just a little concerned about some of the rulings coming out of the Supreme Court. There is another initiative, though, that just popped last week that is really more towards legalizing home grow and allowing each person in a household to have 9 plants to grow at home. Yes. And if there's 2 adults, then it's 18 plants that are allowed in the household, and also allowing for possession. So basically completely decriminalizing possession charges. So that's right out there. So definitely everybody look for your mailboxes. I think that they're going to be mailing them out. And so if not, you can certainly go online and find it and sign the petition and hope that the Supreme Court won't kick this one off the ballot as well.
That would be great. So, but marijuana is not the only issue facing us here in Florida. I think it's a big one, and I'm glad to know you're on the right side. Though I got to say, you released your financial disclosure forms just a couple of weeks ago. The media made a big deal out of it. It was a month or two late, and it does show you have a big stake in one of the big medical marijuana firms. Is that a conflict of interest at all?
Not at all. First of all, it's a very, very small. Okay. These companies are really large. Yes. I have 604 shares of a publicly traded company. And so first of all, I do not regulate medical marijuana. So we can always start there that I have no regulatory oversight that's underneath Department of Health. So there is no conflict of interest. Nothing that I could do inside the Department of Agriculture would have any impact on the stocks of these companies. And two, what I've said very publicly, that if given the opportunity to be the next governor of the state of Florida, where I would regulate, I would be selling my shares way beforehand. So okay. There would be no conflict. Even though part of what we do as elected officials, we have to disclose this information, but there's nothing in ethics laws or anything of that nature that says we can't own, you know, stocks. I mean, look at Rick Scott. I mean, how much?
Oh my God.
You know, he ran, you know, look at his portfolio. He had stocks and everything that he oversaw. So even if that was the case, we would create such a buffer between myself and any involvement with the cannabis space that there would be no inherent conflict. But just to even deal with taking it out of anybody's conversations, I would sell my shares way before I became actually installed as governor.
Gotcha. Okay, that makes sense. Let's talk about some of the other things. Now, before you just got this position, you were elected in 2018, but that was the first time you had ever run for office, yes?
Yes.
And so what were you doing before then?
I'm a practicing attorney. Mm-hmm. So I've been practicing law for about 15 years, everywhere from South Florida to Central Florida to North Florida, everything from a big silk stocking law firm, which was atrocious, did that for a year. Great people, but that was not why I went to law school. I went to law school to give back and to do good. Then went to the public defender's office, where I was in Alachua County for 3.5 years, and then eventually made my way back to South Florida. And then prior to actually running, I was doing government consulting. I was representing Broward School Board, which I'm doing again today. So I never left that hat. Different type of representing them, but fighting with them along the way, fighting for our foster care children, represent an organization that is the voice of our foster care kids in Tallahassee and the medical marijuana space. So that was what I was doing before I ran in 2018 and took that courageous move to give my private life away and to give my life over to public service. And don't regret a single minute of it.
So you want to make the jump from attorney to agriculture commissioner to governor. What makes you qualified to be governor of the state of Florida?
Well, first of all, you know, being again a Floridian my entire life, being a diehard, you know, I've been an activist for issues my entire life. I was fighting for gay pride back in high school and doing Habitat for Humanity and soup kitchens. And so I am passionate about what it is that we need to be doing here in the state. Now, as commissioner, I have been in the executive position and running an agency of 4,600, have $1.3 billion budget. So as far as my executive experience, I'm a small business owner, so I have also real life experience. And you know what? To be governor, you know what you need to know is qualifying aspect of being governor?
What?
You have to care. You have to care for the people that you govern.
Yeah.
That should be our number one qualifier for governor is, do you actually care about the people that you are planning on serving?
I guess that should bring us to talking about the guy currently holding the office, Ron DeSantis. Now, I have fun with his name all the time, but let's get serious here. Actually, when he was running 4 years ago, he was not the favorite. The favorite on the Republican side was Adam Putnam, who I believe, wasn't he the ag commissioner?
He was.
Yep. And he had been groomed to move up and be governor until, of course, Donald Trump comes in, starts talking about this backbencher congressman, Ron DeSantis, and endorsed him. And all of a sudden he shoots up and Adam Putnam is never to be heard from again. I'm not saying whether Adam Putnam would have been, I think anyone would have been better than Ron DeSantis. But this is historically one of the routes taken up through the channels to on the way to governor. Charlie Crist, who's the other Democrat running in the race, actually was governor. And on his way to becoming governor, he was attorney general of the state of Florida. Then when he was elected, he was a Republican. I remember those days back. I was working with Jim DeFede then. And then and then I guess he decided he wanted to go to the Senate, which was a mistake on his part. I guess, you know, Charlie Crist always is looking for the next job. And so and he wound up getting just pilloried, I think, due to the Tea Party movement. So he became an independent, and then eventually he became a Democrat, and now he's running for governor again, this time as a Democrat. Why are you better suited for this job than Charlie Crist?
You know, look, my tagline for my campaign is something new. And that's what we in the state of Florida need. This is what the Democratic Party wants. They want a fresh face, fresh perspective, somebody who's a winner. As somebody who is the only one who has won statewide as a Democrat in this race, and the people want to win. And the other thing that makes me qualified and why I will be the Democratic nominee is I've been a Democrat my entire life. What you are hearing today and people are seeing, I'm the same person that I was back in high school and middle school and elementary school. The same issues that I have been fighting for my entire life are the same issues that I stand up for today, whether it is abortion rights, whether it's criminal justice reform, whether it's medical marijuana and marijuana legalization, whether it's fighting food insecurity and affordable housing. These are issues that I have been in the trenches on, not just policy points that I decided to talk about because I'm running for office. This is why I decided to run, because these are things that have been part of who I am. And in the Jewish faith, which is what I am, we call it tikkun olam, to heal the world. And that is part ingrained in my soul. Everything I do, I wake up every day and say, how can I make the world a better place? And that's why, you know, when people are making a decision on the Democratic primary, they're going to want somebody who is honest. They're going to want somebody who is you know, dedicated to their convictions, somebody who is a fighter, a fierce fighter. I don't turn down challenges. I don't jump from position to position. I'm not a lifetime politician. I can honestly tell the people of the state of Florida, I have no desire to be president. I have no desire, you know, to do anything else besides govern our state. This is it. I'm not looking to, okay, if I don't win this time, I'll run next time. No, I am passionate about this job, this time frame, this position, because we are in a crisis in our country and in our state. And so people of our state need to decide, what side of history are you going to be on? Oh, yeah. Are you going to continue to fight for democracy and the things that we hold true in our state and create history, not only fight for history, create history with the first female governor of our state? And so when I have no doubt that when the Democrats have to make that choice in the ballot box, they will know that we need to try something new, and that we need to have a true winner and fighter in our court. This is going to be a fight that we have never had before in this race. There's going to be more money flowing into the state of Florida than we have ever seen before, more attention on this race than we've ever seen before. And so we need somebody who is battle tested, who is able to take on Ron DeSantis. I make him squirm. he is prone to making mistakes, and I am prone to capitalizing on the mistakes that he makes. So that's why I'm the best suited to be that Democratic nominee and to fight head on with Ron DeSantis.
Nikki Fried is our guest. Again, she's running for governor here in the state of Florida. Find her website at NikkiFried.com, spelled Fried, really, F-R-I-E-D. And on Twitter, same way, at Nikki Fried. All right, so Ron DeSantis is just, Florida's been a mess for a while, but he's made it a ridiculous mess. And there's nothing funny about it. COVID is raging here, even though people are denying it. Not only does he refuse any kind of mask mandates or vaccine mandates or to ask for a vaccine passport, but he ruled unilaterally, I guess, that no school board or any other entity in the state could initiate a mask mandate. Well, many school districts did. You mentioned you represent Broward County. I live in Broward County. I went to Broward County public schools from middle school on up. Where did you grow up?
Miami.
So I went to Miami. Okay. So yeah. I, I went to, Hollywood Hills High School and Olson Middle School. We moved from New York. I went to Olson Middle School. So Broward County and Alachua County, you mentioned, up in Gainesville area, were the first two to say, hold on, our kids are at risk here. We are going to institute a mask mandate. To make a long story short, DeSantis decided he's going to fine. First, he said he's going to fine these school board members $5,000 each if they institute this. Now he's saying he's going to fine individuals. What is he doing? Individuals who allow this to happen? $5,000 or each $5,000 for each employee who gets vaccinated or some nonsense. What is he doing now? You know better than I do.
Yes. So what happened is that he came up with this rule. And that he had an executive order that said that, yes, school districts could not have a mask requirement, mask mandate. And so we saw what happened. And, you know, I was a part of that big fight because I saw what was going on and told our school boards that I was going to get their back. And that's what we did. We called the White House and called the administration and said, this is what is happening in the state of Florida. We need help. And you saw almost days after my call to the White House that both President Biden and his press secretary came out in very strong support and said, look, if we are not going to let that happen. And so has in fact created a grant program for each school district and school board members to apply that if in fact he withholds money, which is now what he's threatening, to withhold their funds that equivalent to their salaries. So it's bad enough that he creates an executive order that he didn't have the power to create to begin with.
Right.
Ben has now gone out of his way to use taxpayer dollars to litigate this issue and continue to litigate this issue. Yep. But it's also now going to be withholding money. And so thank you, President Biden, for stepping up and helping us. What he now has taken is the next step is that we have, they passed a law this past session that says that no employer and no company can ask for, you know, they're calling it a you know, COVID passport.
Right.
I don't want to give in to what they're saying. So it's, you know, requiring the people to show that they have been vaccinated.
Right.
And so they are not allowed to do that, which again is crazy. We're in the middle of a healthcare crisis. And most importantly, whatever happened to free market? I was talking to a gentleman earlier today who owns barbecue restaurants all across the state of Florida. And I said to him, I said, look, if you so choose to want to make, you know, having vaccines for your patrons and know that you're going to lose 10 or 15% of your business to the Sunnies down the road, that's a business decision that is on you to make. It's not the government's decision. It should be you as a business owner. But now what he's done, and so that law did not touch employees. But now he's saying, wait a sec. And he actually has a press conference back in the day when this bill was passed that said it did not impact employees. And that was a personal decision and government shouldn't be involved in that. And now he's coming out and saying for every government agency, both as a school district, hospitals, law enforcement, first responders, and then local governments puts in any requirement that their employees get vaccinated, each incident,
$5,000.
$5,000 fine.
Unbelievable. We're living crazy down here. It's just unbelievable. It is stunning to me. And I walk around and I hear people regurgitating lies, stuff that's just simply not true. And they're getting it from this man. Nikki Fried, now I heard you're not in favor of mask mandates, are you?
So what I am in favor of is, you know, first of all, I called for mask mandate last year. I was very in front of the issue and said that that was really important. And I continue to say that we have to be masking. We have to follow the CDC guidelines. And the CDC guidelines, it's very clear. Mm-hmm. Anywhere you are indoors, you should be masking.
That's
up.
Right.
So I have said very clearly that we need to be following the CDC guidelines, which would be masking up everywhere inside, including in our schools. But I've also said that I believe in our local electeds, both on our city and county commissioners and our school boards, to be doing what is right for their communities and given the power to do that. Because look, at the end of the day, it was our county and city commissioners last year that all stepped up to the plate and got us through this pandemic. It was our business community and our local electeds, not the governor. The governor ran ahead. He hid behind everything and it was like, oh, I don't know what to do here, and allowed our locals to do it. And they did. And they stepped up and it was seamless. This time around, he wants all the power and doesn't want our local governments to do it. So I have been trying to empower our local governments They're the ones who are closest to the people, and that's where government should be, is closest to the people. They know their communities the best, and that's really where any kinds of requirements should be. But I've been very staunch on saying we need to be following the CDC guidelines, which is masking
good.
Up.
Okay, good to know. We've only got a few minutes left, and I have a million more questions for you, so maybe we can get together again. But I want to ask about redistricting, because that's coming up. And back 10 years ago, here in Florida, we passed a constitutional amendment, Fair Districts Florida, to have the congressional districts, all districts, drawn by an independent, nonpartisan committee. And that hasn't happened. It's all still very partisan. And here we go again. They're getting ready to redraw the districts, despite the fact that there are more registered Democrats in the state of Florida. Republicans control the legislature. What's going to happen here, and what should happen?
I'm very nervous. I've talked to our leadership in the House and the Senate. I've talked to our party leadership. I've talked to grassroots organizations, to labor organizations. This is going to be an all-on assault gerrymandering at its worst. And so we have also seen is that there's also no transparency. They're not having hearings. Even 10 years ago, they went around the state and still had workshops and still had hearings. They have no intention of doing that this time around. And so I have said very clearly to all of my contemporaries in the Democratic Party and activists and grassroots organizations that we need to be getting that message out now. The message is very clear. This is going to be a partisan-driven process, and it's not going to be transparent. And they are going to gerrymander these districts against the Constitution. And unfortunately, we don't have the courts. The courts are not going to fare in a fair way, unfortunately. And the Supreme Court is more likely than not going to back up the maps that are coming out of the legislature. So this is something that we, the people, need to be talking about, getting in front of, be messaging with our elected officials on the Senate and the House, and tell them that that's not okay. And even if, this is what I keep saying too, even if the worst case outcome happens and they gerrymander these districts, we have got to vote like we have never voted before. And the NPAs that are out there are going to be the ones who have to help us hold them accountable and elect them out of office. But we're going to need everybody to understand.
NPA is no party affiliation. Right.
Yes.
Independence. Yes. Making sure everyone knows what you're talking about. Yeah.
Yes. And that we are going to need our non-party voters out there to stand up and say enough is enough. Enough of not following the Constitution. Enough of not following the statutes. Enough of creating a state that is only there to help the top 1%ers and the people that are staying in power. And they've got to stand up. And there's a reason why that they are NPAs, because they are tired of all of this.
Right.
And they don't want to pick a party. So it's time to send the party that has been in office for 25 straight years packing, because they are not following the rules anymore.
Well, let me tell you something from a registered Democrat, who is, because the alternative is so much worse. But the Democratic Party here in Florida is ineffective at best. And I'm being really generous here. I have a foul potty mouth, but I'm respecting who I have on with me, and I'm not going there. But I actually ran. I became a precinct committee person to help a progressive influx of voices into the Florida Democratic Party. The Florida Democratic Party has done everything they can to diss the progressive wing. They elected Manny Diaz as chair of the Democratic Party of Florida, who was the last person who should have a role in certainly Democratic Party politics, but any politics. I'm so disgusted with the party. It is dysfunctional on its best day and horrific on its worst. In fact, Manny Diaz took it upon himself to put out a press release excoriating the progressive caucus inside the Florida Democratic Party rather than dealing with moving forward. So that's I'm hoping if you get in there, you will somehow take control of the Democratic Party and whip it into shape, because that's another, I'm sorry, it's not working well for you, for any of us right now.
Yeah, and there is huge problems. And I think that part of the problem is this. We haven't had, and I came in and I have been very honest too about this. I didn't wear, like, I've been a Democrat my entire life, but I haven't been involved in the Democratic Party. So my, when I first came into office, I didn't know a lot of the party leaders. I didn't know the chairs of each of the counties and the clubs. And so I spent a lot of time the last 2.5 years getting ingratiated with everybody, learning who everybody is, who, what is the background of some of the party stuff. And so it has been really important for me to get that ground, because you are right that there is such dysfunction within the party. And so I spent a lot of time on the phones, especially after November of 2020, listening and talking and giving them advice and suggestions about how to organize, how to fundraise, how to make sure that we are not going to the voters just before an election. That's not a winning combination. We got to be constantly, you know, going to the communities, going and talking to them and doing what I'm calling value added. You know, go, if it's Broward County, Broward should be doing beach cleanups every other weekend. They should be building Habitat for Humanities. If you're on the West Coast, you should be doing this and you should be doing that. How are we as Democrats showing the people of our state that we care more about them and the communities than we care about winning an election? And so the only way that we're going to win is to make people truly understand that we as a party care about their lives, care about making sure that there's food on their plates, that there's home, that there's roofs over their heads, that they've got, you know, good paying jobs, and showing that support on the local level consistently. So what I have said, it's all about the message. It's having a consistent message, consistently messaging, and trusted messengers. And until the Democratic Party can figure out how to get that right, and I certainly hope that I am the conduit to make that happen in November of 2022. I've got not to be on air kind of conversation, but certainly I've got a game plan of how we're going to win in November, and how to make sure that we are building our bench and how we are organizing like we have never organized in the state. And it's going to take a leader that truly understands all of that to bring everybody together and start turning the page of this and bringing our party together. There shouldn't be internal fighting within the party. And unfortunately, that happens. And so we need a trusted leader to bring everybody together. And so, you know, given that I, you know, we'll be the nominee in August and then win in November, then we will be able to truly create a party that is sustainable and aren't turning over new leaders every 2 years, which is what has happened, and not have an internal structure in place.
All right. Nikki Fried, again, find her at NikkiFried.com, on Twitter at Nikki Fried. And by the way, you said say hi to Jim DeFiti for you.
Yes.
Jim's there. You can say hello.
Hello, Jim.
Jim DeFiti.
Hello. Yeah, long time no see. I was also a couple weekends ago, I was watching that fantastic
Come From Away. Right?
Cowboys. Cocaine Cowboys.
Oh, Cocaine Cowboys. You're all over Cocaine Cowboys, Jim DeFiti.
You're all over it.
We're going to talk about that in a minute. Yes.
You're growing up in Miami, knew those stories too well.
Oh yes. All right.
Well, now that you're you know, wrapping up with Nicole and going national, maybe next time you have an invitation to come on my show and
anytime
talk about some of these issues.
I love it.
All right, Nikki, thank you so much. It was a pleasure meeting you. We'll talk again, I hope. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thanks.
All right. You take care. Bye bye.